In our last video segment, we're going to turn away from taxes and look at subsidies. Now, of course, when there's a tax on an activity, the government has you pay them money when you undertake the activity. So it's a discouragement. When there's a subsidy, the government gives you money for undertaking the activity, encouraging you to do more of the activity. When we think about how the subsidy is going to affect the demand and supply curves, notice that a subsidy for buyers raises people's effective willingness to pay, because they know that the government's going to reward them for the activity. And so we're going to cause the demand curve to shift up, and it's going to shift up by the amount of the subsidy. If we have a subsidy for sellers, then the government is offsetting some of the sellers' costs. And so the supply curve is going to shift down by the amount of the subsidy. And let me go ahead and illustrate that in two examples. Let's suppose we have a $10,000 subsidy for homeowners. So it's paid to home buyers, And we're going to go ahead and see the demand curve is going to shift up by $10,000. And that's this arrow here. That's going to go ahead and cause a change in the market price. And it's going to cause a change in the market price, in this case, of $8,000, because that's where our new intersection of demand and supply is. Notice that if the supply curve had been 100% vertical, then all that would have happened would be that we would have pushed up price, and we wouldn't have any change in quantity. On the other hand, if the supply curve had been 100% horizontal, then we would have had no change in price, but we would have had a large change in quantity. So generally speaking, the slope of the supply curve is going to tell us how much of the subsidy goes to pushing up prices and how much of the subsidy goes to pushing up quantity. We could also think about a subsidy for sellers. And again, a subsidy for sellers pushes down seller costs and so pushes the supply curve to a lower elevation. And we're going to have a new intersection of supply and demand. And the effect on quantity and price is going to depend on the shape of the demand curve. If the demand curve had been 100% vertical, then the supply curve shift would have put us to a situation where it intersected demand somewhere like here. So it wouldn't have changed quantity at all, but it would have had a strong increase on price. If the demand curve had been a 100% horizontal, then our new intersection of demand and supply would be somewhere over here. There would have been no impact on price, but there would have been a really strong impact on the quantity. So the shape or elasticity of the demand curve is going to determine how much of the subsidy goes to change prices and how much of the subsidy goes to change the quantity transacted. Notice that either type of subsidy, either a subsidy for a buyer or a subsidy for a seller, forms a kind of bridge between the price that customers pay and the price sellers receive. This is in contrast to the tax, which created a wedge between those two. But, and in contrast to the tax, which caused the quantity to fall, the subsidy causes the quantity to grow. The government's spending here is analogous to the tax revenue. Tax revenue was tax per transaction times the number of transactions. The total spending on the subsidy is the subsidy per transaction times the quantity of transactions. And you want to remember that we're talking about the quantity of transactions after the subsidy is introduced. What about the incidence of the subsidy? We saw before that the incidence of taxation doesn't depend on which side of the market we tax. The same thing holds true for a subsidy. The incidence mainly lies with the less elastic curve, and that's exactly the same result as we saw with the incidence of a tax. Specifically, if we go back to our previous case, for the homeowners, there was a $10,000 subsidy. Of that, $8,000 went to push up the market price. So $8,000 of the $10,000 was a benefit to sellers. If market price rises by $8,000 and you got paid $10,000, you're still $2,000 better off. So the incidence of the subsidy was $8,000 worth of benefit for the sellers and $2,000 for the buyers. Likewise, in our ethanol subsidy example, we had a $1 subsidy, and that $1 subsidy pushed prices down by 70 cents. Obviously, buyers are 70 cents better off if prices are 70 cents lower. Sellers got paid a dollar, but they're getting 70 cents less, so on net, they're 30 cents better off. Notice that for the inframarginal units, for the units that were transacted before the subsidy was introduced, what happens here is that people get a dollar, the government spends a dollar, but nobody's behavior has changed, so there's no impact on economic efficiency. For the new units, notice that we're in a situation where the fundamental cost to supply the good is really up here, and the fundamental amount that people value the good is really down here. So these are loss-making transactions. We can make people think that they're wealth-creating transactions by giving them money, but of course that wealth had to come from somewhere. So we're going to have some deadweight loss from these transactions, and these red triangles and these diagrams represent the deadweight loss from these transactions. So the triangle to the right of that equilibrium is the deadweight loss. What can we say about the effectiveness of subsidies? So in the examples that I gave here, one of the curves was inelastic. So our subsidies didn't really produce large increases in the amount of activity. So that's the second case here. Our combined elasticity is relatively low. So we didn't increase a really strong increase in the amount of transactions. If we had had a really high combined elasticity, then the subsidy would have produced a larger increase in the activity. And that's exactly the same situation as we saw before. We can even sort of start to think about how many extra transactions do we get per dollar of subsidy. So, in our home subsidy example, after the subsidy was established, we had 110 homes being transacted, and we had a $10,000 subsidy. So the total cost of that subsidy would have been $1,100,000. We had 10 extra transactions, and so we see that the spending per increased sale would be $110,000. And obviously that's kind of a lot per increased sale. If we look at our ethanol example, we had 24 transactions after the subsidy was established. The subsidy was $1, so the government would have had to write $24 worth of checks to get that subsidy paid for. We had 4 extra transactions. We spent $24 to achieve them, so $6 per transaction. So this is sort of the way you would measure the effectiveness of the subsidy in increasing the amount of production or consumption of the good. And it's pretty common that you really end up having a pretty high cost per extra transaction in a lot of these cases, because essentially you pay the subsidy to all the transactions that are already happening. If you can find a way to target the subsidy more narrowly so that you only subsidize transactions that would have otherwise not occurred, then you're going to be able to go ahead and improve this because you don't have to pay the subsidy to all the pre-existing transactions. A third way to sort of look at these things is maybe the point of the subsidy isn't to increase the amount of the transaction, but rather simply to transfer economic welfare. So in this case, what we would sort of look at is, well, how much did we pay out in subsidies relative to deadweight loss? And if we go back and compute the size of the deadweight loss triangle in our homeowner example, we would see that the base of this triangle is $10,000. The height is 10 homes, so 1/2 base times height is going to be 1/2 times 10 times 10,000, or $50,000. So $50,000 worth of deadweight loss compared to $110,000, sorry, $1,100,000 paid out, we'd see that our deadweight loss is only about 5% of our transfer. And if you think back to the previous lecture series, looking at something like price controls, where we saw the deadweight loss was something like 80% of the transfer, you can see why this looks like a much more attractive way to redistribute economic welfare if that's something you want to achieve. Likewise, in my ethanol example, if we did all the math there, we would have the area of the deadweight loss triangle being 1/2 base times height. The height would be $1. Sorry, the base would be $1. The height would be 4 units. The area of our triangle would be 1/2 times 4 times $1. So the area of our triangle would be the area of our triangle would be 1/2 times 4 times $1, $2 of deadweight loss. And here our deadweight loss is about 8% of the transfer. So again, a pretty efficient way to redistribute economic welfare if that's an objective you want to achieve here. So I think the lesson here would be that oftentimes we think about subsidies as a way to increase the amount of an activity. And there's some serious question about exactly how effective they are in this. On the other hand, they are pretty effective at redistributing economic welfare. So if we want to do that, then subsidies may be an attractive way to do that.